Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to the CEC-UGC live lecture. Dear friends, we would like to share with you all that today we would be continuing our series further on history of literary English criticism, and under this very series today we would be talking on Philip Sidney. And for this very discussion we have once again with us in our studios Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya. Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya is a retired professor of English. He is formerly vice chancellor of Kurukshetra University. He has authored numerous books and he has taught in numerous universities and colleges. So let's welcome our guest Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya and let's talk more and more on Philip Sidney. Hello sir, welcome to the UGC lecture.
Thank you.
Well, beginning with English criticism, history of English criticism. Last time we did the heritage of English criticism, and its heritage comes from the Greco-Roman tradition, because they were the ancient nations and they had the ancient history of literature and literary criticism. In that heritage, we saw how the English relied upon this heritage, which was Plato and Aristotle to begin with. Plato, of course, is known for his opposition to poetry and arts. He had made a very damaging remark against poetry and had said that in his ideal republic, there will be no place for the poets. They will be banished from the republic. Well, Aristotle, his own student or disciple, he gave a befitting reply to it and wrote the Poetics, in which he not only defended poetry, he went into the details of the different forms of poetry, and in each form, like epic and tragedy and comedy, he wrote separate books on each, showing in detail the different parts, different purposes, so on and so forth. So continuing with that history of English criticism, today we will take up the first English critic of the Renaissance, Philip Sidney. And Renaissance was the first literary age of the English. That's where the great literature came out. Of course, earlier in the medieval times, there was only one significant poet, Chaucer, Geoffrey Chaucer. He is known for those Canterbury Tales and so on. But thereafter, there is a gap of many, many years, in fact, many decades. And then comes the 16th century, called Renaissance. In Europe, it had begun in 14th century in Italy, but it reaches England in the 16th century. And during the Renaissance, it also means revival of the ancient Greco-Roman learning, which was secular. It is important, this revival, because all these years, more than a decade, there was the dominance of religion, medieval times, and nothing but religion. Even poetry had to be written in praise of religion, nothing else. So it was only during the Renaissance that the poets got a sense of liberation, freedom, and they wrote poetry the way they wanted, expressing their ideas, their emotions, their thoughts, their feelings freely. And that's why during the Renaissance, there is a real upsurge of writing. You have the most successful dramatic tradition. Shakespeare was a product of the same tradition. The greatest dramatist known to the world even today, including all the languages of the world, he is considered the greatest. So he was during that time, 16th century. And not only he, there were several more. Marlowe was there before him. Ben Jonson was there. And then a long list of other dramatists followed. And then there was a great poet called Edmund Spenser. He wrote that epic poem, The Faery Queen, which is a very long poem running into 12 books. So it was really a great age of English literature, not merely poetry, not merely drama, but even prose and fiction. They came up. Bacon's Essays, for example, early 17th century. It was a part of the same period. And that was the beginning of the essays, and so on and so forth. Even novel, in some form, utopia, another form of writing. So all forms of literary writing made their beginnings during the Renaissance. And here Philip Sidney, being the first literary critic of England, is of significance. Therefore, we will take up what he has to say. As for years, it was in 1579 that one Puritan called Philip Gosson, G-O-S-S-A-N, he wrote a nasty piece against the poets, and he called it The Abuse of Poetry, and the School of Abuse. He called poets the School of Abuse and wrote against them that they are irresponsible people, they are immoral people, they sell lies to the innocent public, so on and so forth. So let us look into this history, Philip Gosson. And in reply to his charges, his nasty comments on the poets, Philip Sidney decided to write a piece called An Apology for Poetry. In fact, this appeared in two editions and under two different titles. One was An Apology for Poetry, the other was The Defense of Poesy. So both these titles are relevant, and they could be published quite late in 1595, although they were written in 1580. But it took 15 years to get them published. And that goes to the credit of Philip Sidney. He was also a poet. In fact, he's better known as a poet. But then, since he made a beginning of the English literary criticism, it is of all the more significance, his contribution to the literary criticism in English. So let us have a look at the Defense of Poesy, or An Apology for Poetry. What has he to say about it? Well, to begin with, he underlines the significance of poetry. He says, poets were the first writers in the world, not only in England, but long ago in Greek and Latin. And he gives the example of India also. He says, even in India, it were the poets who were the first writers over 2,000 years ago. So this, he says, in itself is significant, and it is important. This shows the importance of poetry. So he's saying all this in reply to Gosson's charges that it is children's plaything, this, that, and all kinds of nonsense he said against the poets. So Sidney, defending the poets, says that poets were the first writers. And he says not only the first writers, they were honored, they were respected, they were held in high esteem, not just poets, because they were considered the seers, the prophets, the lawgivers, the wisest men in society. So he underlines this importance of the poets. And then he comes to what poetry actually is, after underlining its significance. Then he explains what poetry is, and he compares it to other writings of the time. He says there is history on one side and philosophy on the other. He says, as for philosophy, it deals in abstractions. What is good? What is evil? What is man? What is God? So it gives definitions, it gives concepts, but all in abstraction. On the other hand, the historian gives examples, historical personages. It may be Alexander. It may be, you see, Henry IV or Henry VIII or Richard III, Richard II. All these historical personages, rulers, administrators, you see, they figure in the writings of historians. Sidney's point is that while philosophers give only abstractions of good and evil, just definitions, historians gives only examples. So both in their own positions are incomplete. And he says it is poetry alone which gives both. It gives example as well as the precept. What is good and what is evil? But it does not argue like the philosopher in abstractions. Nor does it give just examples without giving any direction of what is good and what is evil. So it is in this sense, Sidney says, that poetry combines both history and philosophy. You have living characters, you have stories, fables, tales, and there is always a moral message in every poetic writing, even prose writing or dramatic writing, whatever writing in literature, there is always good and evil. And it is good that finally triumphs over the evil. Satan is an evil figure in the Bible. So does he become in Milton's Paradise Lost? But then he loses finally, and the Son of God, Christ, he wins. So similarly, in our own epics, Ramayana and Mahabharata, you have Ram, the hero, and you have from Sri Lanka, the villain, so to say, against him. But finally, it is the hero who wins. Similarly, in Mahabharata, you have the Pandavas, you have the Kauravas. And there is a conflict between good and evil. The better people and the not so good people. And finally, it is the triumph of the good. So our epics also endorse the same thing. And that underlines the purpose of literary writing. That literary writing is to promote good and to dismiss evil. That evil is to be discarded, evil is to be shunned, and good is to be wooed, good is to be embraced, and good is to be followed and practiced. This is what literature does, and it is this argument which Philip Sidney gives to begin with. First, he underlines the importance of poetry. Secondly, he shows how poetry promotes morality, the sense of good, and by showing the triumph of good. So these two important things he says, and then he comes to defining poetry. And he gives the example of Plato and before him the Greeks and Romans. So from the very beginning he says, this has been there. And then among the Romans, a poet was called Wats, V-A-T-E-S. I wonder if our Wats has anything to do with it. And then he gives the example of Christianity also. He says the Christian Psalms, P-S-A-L-M-S, it is called Psalms, but actually spelled P-S-A-L-M-S. He says these prophecies also, they are written in poetry. So every important thing in every community, every religion, every race has been written in poetry. Even our Hindu scriptures, it may be Vedas and Shastras, it may be Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is a poem. So all important documents of religion, race, community, they are found to have been written in poetry. So Philip Sidney gives these examples to underline the importance of poetry. He says people like Gosson, they are ignorant. They don't know what poetry is because Gosson was a Puritan, and Puritans were against all arts, including poetry, because they will buy only one thing, the word of God, and propagate the word of God. So single-minded, one-track mind, and going on the narrow path, ignoring everything else in life. So Sidney reminds them of this, people like Gosson, the Puritans. And it is important because in the early 17th century, Puritans' presence had become very prominent. And there came a time when they captured power also. They ruled England for some years. But that was the worst period of English history because people were not allowed to do most things. And they were feeling choked by the iron discipline of the Puritans. And no wonder then they were replaced by the king. And the old system came back and people got the kind of freedom they wanted. And there was revival of literature also. So this is what Sidney is talking about. And he then cites Aristotle, defining what poetry is. He says Aristotle had said long ago, almost 2,000 years ago, before 16th century, before Sidney comes on the scene. And he says Aristotle had said that poetry is an art of mimesis. Mimesis in Greek means imitation. So it is mimetic art, imitative art, art of imitation. What does it imitate? It imitates life. And that's why it may be poetry, it may be drama, it may be novel, anything, or even the shortest poem, lyrics, sonnets, songs. What do they imitate? They imitate one part or another of life. The short forms, they imitate the human emotions, feelings. Then you see your perspectives on different things. So in short poems, this is done. In long poems, they give you stories, tales, fables of our life, from our life, both tragic as well as comic. If the ending is sad, it becomes a tragedy in drama on the stage. And if the ending is happy, the couples are married or lost brothers meet each other, so on and so forth, then it becomes comedy. Happy ending story is comedy. Sad ending in death mostly, is a tragedy. So Shakespeare was the greatest name. He continues to be the greatest name in world literature. He wrote 39 plays in which there are histories, there are romances, there are tragedies, there are comedies. On the whole, these four dominant forms he practiced and entertained the English audience for so many years. In the last decade of the 16th century and the first decade of the 17th, that is when he was writing for the stage. Started as an actor, but later became a director, writer, producer, even partner in the, you see, organization. So made a name for himself and continues to be there even today. So that is how Sidney defines poetry. Poesy, therefore, is an art of imitation. For so Aristotle termed it in his word, my message. That is to say, a representing, counterfeiting, or figuring forth, to speak metaphorically, speaking picture with this end, to teach and to delight. So, Sidney gives complete definition of poetry. Not only poetry, literature as a whole. It includes drama, it includes fiction, it includes poetry, romances, histories. There are all possibilities, all kinds of literary writing has been there. But he says, the end of all forms of writing is common. And that end is to teach and to delight. Because it is not just entertainment for its own sake. The entertainment has a purpose behind it. And that purpose is to, you see, sensitize the audience, to sensitize people to the morality of life. What is good and what is bad? What is virtuous and what is vicious? What is to be done and what is not to be done? So a man of religion, he will be preaching that very thing in abstractions. A philosopher will be giving definitions in abstraction. But a literary person, he may be a dramatist, or a novelist, or a poet, lyricist. You see, he does not give abstractions. He gives you stories, gives you examples, gives you characters, gives you situations, and through them, he teaches. So he teaches by example, not by definition nor by abstraction. So this is what Sidney has to say about poetry, and he goes on giving examples from different literatures, and then comes to different forms of poetry. And he says poetry has different faces. It is of different kinds. The heroic, for example, the heroic poetry is epic poetry. And it is heroic because it is about the heroes, the warriors, the leaders of society, like Mahabharata is, Ramayana is. They are epics, and they are in praise of the heroes. It may be Ram, or it may be Arjun. They are the heroes of the respective epics in which they appear. And this is done through an entertaining fable. So delight, to delight and to teach, both go side by side, simultaneously. In the delight lies the moral also. So they are inseparable. That's where we stop, take a break, we'll come back. Okay, well, to resume the story, Sidney makes out a sharp difference between poetry and other forms of knowledge. This too is a form of knowledge. It may be giving by example, but that too is knowledge about life in general. And he gives the example of sciences as opposed to literature. He says in sciences, first, it is not general knowledge about life. It is particular knowledge about some, you see, aspect of life. It may be botany, zoology, physics, chemistry, so on and so forth. Some about plants, some about some other thing, even about animals. So these are sciences which give you knowledge about what actually is. Whereas literature gives you knowledge about what ought to be. What is the ideal? What we should aim at? What is the target of life? And not merely describing things or telling things what are there. We know things that are there. But then, whether they are good or bad, whether they are life-supporting or life-destroying, that distinction, to sensitize people on that point of morality, of good and bad, because that takes you towards the ultimate goal of life. Otherwise, there will be no difference between humans and animal species. Animals do not have education. Animals do not have this moral sense of what is good or what is bad. They keep doing things, even causing destruction, without being aware of it. But humans are superior among these species precisely because they have this sense. They have developed education and morality and moral sense of what is good and what is not good. So that is where Sidney makes a beginning. And he says, poetry is an art of imitation, a representing, counterfeiting, or figuring forth a speaking picture with this end to teach and delight. So these are speaking pictures, not merely in drama, even in poetry, even in prose. Because a literary person, a literary writer, does not represent things like philosopher in the abstraction, and does not represent things like the historian, just examples, without making a reference to their moral position. But a man of literature combines both history and philosophy. He gives you the sense of what is good and what is evil, and at the same time gives examples for both. So that is the difference. And this is what Sidney says. It is that feigning notable images of virtues, vices, or what else, with that delightful teaching, which must be the right describing note to know a poet by. So not merely teaching, because otherwise there will be no difference between a religious preacher and a literary preacher. The difference is that the preacher in literature does it through delight, through entertainment. He gives you stories, fables, songs, lyrics, but through them he inducts the morality of what is good and what is not good. So that is the difference between the philosopher and historian on the one side and a man of literature on the other. He is superior because, Sidney says, he is superior because he combines the functions of both. They are incomplete each by itself, whereas literature is complete both ways. whilst then he compares literature or poetry to sciences. First he compared poetry to philosophy and history, now other sciences. He says, while sciences impart knowledge only, giving no moral edge of virtue and vice to their discourses, poetry must conclude on the moral note. No wonder we have heroes and villains in Shakespeare's tragedies, and balanced and distracted characters in the comedies. So that is the difference. Sciences give you technical knowledge, just technical, nothing human about it. Even the human sciences, it may be zoology or biology, life sciences I mean, even they are neutral so far as morality of life is concerned. They will only tell you what is what. The organism of our body, of our mind, of other things, just their technical knowledge. But literature does not stop at that. It goes further and tells you not merely the functions of different organisms or different parts of the organism, but also tells what is good functioning and what is malfunctioning, what is good and evil, what is bad and what is desirable. So this distinction is peculiar to poetry alone or literature alone. It's not there in other sciences or even other humanities. It may be political science, history, so on and so forth. Literature alone combines all sciences, all humanities, and on the top of it, sensitizes you to what is good and what is bad, what is virtuous and what is vicious, what is desirable on the part of humans and what is not desirable, what is expected of them, what is not expected. So that's how he goes on. And then he says, only the poet disdaining to be tied to any subjection, lifted up with the vigor of his own invention, doth grow in effect into Mother Nature, in making things either better than nature brings forth or quite anew, forms such as never were in nature, as the heroes, demigods, cyclopes, chimeras, furies, and such like. The point that Sidney is trying to make is that while other knowledges, other sciences, they just tell you what is what. But in poetry, the poet creates. He does not give you a picture of nature. The other sciences give you what nature is. It may be plants, it may be humans, it may be animals, or it may be their internal organisms. That is all that science would do. But poetry, he says, creates, recreates nature through imagination. It imagines a parallel world of its own. Sorry. In Shakespeare, for example, you have good characters, you have bad characters, you have heroes, you have villains, you have fools, you have comic characters. All kinds are there. But then finally, when you close the book, finish the play, then you sit and think, yes, so and so was right, so and so is heroic, so and so is villainous, he was bad, etc., etc. Sidney says this sense, this moral sense, of discrimination between what is good and what is evil is given only by poetry, only by literature, and by no other science. Hence, he says, poetry is supreme. And that is why all the great scripts in every religion, in every race, in every community, whatever is sanctimonious in any culture, that is written in poetic form. So he highlights the importance of poetry, defense of poesy. And why he has to write a defense or an apology? As I said in the very beginning, it is the historical context. In the early 17th century or late 16th century, there came a dominance of the Puritans in England. They came to rule the country and rule with a firm hand. Dictatorially, that you would do this and would not do that. So even your private life was determined by the rulers. What you should be reading, what you should be eating, all that was decided by religion, just as in medieval ages. So it is against that that Philip Sidney is reacting and writing in defense of poesy. He's writing in defense because he says it is under attack and it has become a laughing stock even for the children. They laugh at the artists. They laugh at songs, poems, poetry, drama, and so on. So things have come to such a pass. For Sidney, it's a degeneration. Puritans may think very high of themselves. But he says, the end result of their effort is negative because humans lose their moral sense, lose their sense of what is good, what is right, and what is not good and not right. So it is on these lines that he offers the defense of poesy. And he goes on. And he says, there are many mysteries continued in poetry, which are purpose written darkly, lest by profane wits it should be abused to believe with Landino that they are so beloved of the gods that whatsoever they write proceeds of a divine fury, lastly to believe themselves. When they tell you, they will make you immortal by their verses. Sidney finally is saying two things. One, against the fake poetry, and the other, the danger. The danger inherent in the opposition to poetry. So simultaneously, he is hitting on both sides. The inferior poetry, the fake poetry as he calls it, is also a danger because in the name of poetry, it teaches you wrong things. He calls such people as versifiers. They write in verse. They write in rhyme and meter, but then within the body of that poetry, rhyme is all right. It creates some sort of music, some sorts of connotations, but then the end result is negative. What does it teach? It may delight all right, but he says the proper function of poetry is to delight and teach. Teaching through delight, but these versifiers, there were plenty. all sorts of poetasters. They are called poetasters out of contempt and condemnation. They are not proper poets. They can only rhyme lines, but that doesn't make poetry. So on the one hand, he makes a distinction between just versification, just rhyming, and proper poetry. On the other, he makes a distinction between poetry proper and its distractors. Distractors like Gosson, who pose to be moralists, but actually the end result of their effort is negative. They do not make people moral. Whereas poetry which claims to delight people, to entertain people, actually makes them moral. It sensitizes them through example, through entertainment, what they ought to be doing and what they ought not to be doing. So that is the greatest contribution of poetry. And that's why Sidney says, you go back into the beginnings of any civilization, any culture, history of any community or race, and you will find the start was always in poetry. Any kind of writing, even our own, you see, religious Hindu scriptures or the Islam, you see, scripture or Christian scripture. So it may be Bhagavad Gita, it may be Quran, it may be Bible, all are literary pieces in the sense that they are written in poetry form. So poetry is important, he says, because it has been a medium of all the important writing, from religion on one side to the entertainers on the other. So both extremes, in between various other forms of poetry and other forms of entertainment. So the better one, he says, he makes a choice also. He makes an emphasis also. And the emphasis is on poetry proper. That on the one hand, there may be puritanical kind of poetry, which is harsh and mere teaching. On the other, there may be pure buffoonery, entertainment, and no proper teaching. He says, in between stands poetry, where it takes the best of both. Best from the puritanical kind, the teaching, the moral teaching, and best from buffoonery, entertainment. So it teaches through delight. That is its distinction. And that's why he says it is superior to all other forms of writing, maybe scientific, maybe artistic. And therefore, he values it. And in this long, you see, document, in fact, he has to do it under two different titles. In one, an apology for poetry. The other, the defense of poesy. Because two different editions. But then it took quite some time before he could get them published. Times being what they were, harsh times. Harsh for poetry and poets proper. And therefore, whereas Gosson's attack on poetry under the title The Abuse of Poetry, that came in 1579. And Sidney's defense of poetry, that came out in 1695. 16 years after, a big gap, but it could not be helped because keeping in view the dominance of the Puritans, even a publisher would not dare bring out something which goes against their grain, which challenges their position. Therefore, carefully and with all the caution on their part, they had to bring it out. It was brought out, as I said, under two different titles, but it did come out, although it took a long time. 16 years is not a small time. It took 16 years. But Sidney made a mark, and that is why he becomes the first literary critic in the English tradition, in the English history. In fact, English literature, criticism, all forms of literature and literary criticism, they came into their own during the 16th century. Before that, you have very poor sort of writing during the medieval ages. And it is these writers of the 16th century, they brought about the Renaissance, which had started in Italy. 14th century took 200 years to reach England in the 16th century. But then it became the greatest period in literary history. Even today, it is considered the most important. Just think of the galaxy of great writers, beginning with Marlowe in drama, Spenser in poetry. And it goes on from Marlowe to Ben Jonson to Shakespeare, so on and so forth. So many. Similarly, among poets, Spenser, Sidney, Skelton, so on and so forth again. A long list of poets, a long list of dramatists, a long list of literary criticism. So all round excellence in literary writing came about in the 16th century. And no wonder it is called the Renaissance period of English literary history. With this, I think we stop today's lecture. Thank you. ठीक है? है गीतिका? सॉरी, 5 मिनट पहले कर दिया मैंने. I thought there was no point in repeating.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much for giving us a very, very vivacious session on Philip Sidney. And dear friends, we believe that you have liked today's lecture. So if you want to give your feedback for this particular lecture, then you can mail us at info.cec@nic.in, and definitely this lecture can be viewed the number of times you wanted, as we are going to upload this lecture on YouTube very soon. So, sir, what else are we going to study under this series of History of English Criticism?
Oh, it will go on. It's a long history. Next will come 17th century, John Dryden, 18th century, Alexander Pope, 19th century, Wordsworth Coleridge, Romantic Age, then Victorian, Matthew Arnold and Peter, and then 20th. It is a long story.
It's a long story which we would be covering under the series. And when we're talking about different eras and different stages, does the writings of the writers changes, or the ultimate essence remains the same?
No. It, in a way, same, but at the same time, significant changes. because the outlook on life keeps changing, and literature is related to life. After all, it's a mirror, as Hamlet says, as it were, holding mirror up to nature. So it only reflects life. If life changes, literature also changes. That is why the history of literature actually is history of any nation to which the literature belongs.
Definitely, and with the life is connected the society, and whatever changes occurs in the society,
it reflects the mirror.
Definitely. With this note, we would like to thank once again Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya for giving us a very, very productive session. And dear friends, keep watching us, keep writing us. Your feedbacks are very, very important for us. As well as if you want to ask any question from Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya, your questions are welcome. And the next time when Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya visits our studio, we will try to give answers to your questions. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.